Hi, I'm Jennifer Elizabeth Masters, and I had kind of an event where a client was telling me about something going on in their household, and I felt compelled to share it because I don't know about you, but I grew up with critical parents, and if you've had critical parents, you understand the concept and what it can do to you. So in my case, I had a mother that was extremely critical, and my father was too, but my dad was not around a lot. He worked, you know, when we were home, and worked shift work, so it was mostly my mom. And for me, I felt like I could never do enough, never be good enough, never do whatever it was that she was asking to in the best way possible. Whatever it was that I did, it was never enough. And, you know, so when that happens, then we feel unloved. We feel that we're not accepted, and our self-esteem is in the toilet. So when we don't feel good about ourselves, and we've got a parent that is constantly criticizing, constantly controlling, and trying to help us, what happens is then we internalize that and we criticize ourselves. Hi, Deb. It's good to see you here. What are you doing up so late? So when we have critical parents, we internalize those things that they say to us, and then we start playing a story or tapes in our head about we're not good enough, we're not loved. You know, we might look at ourselves and go, well, you know, my nose is too big, my eyes are too small, my breasts are too small, my butt's too big. We criticize everything about ourselves, and when we do that, then what eventually starts to happen, and that's what happened with me, when we're constantly criticizing ourselves, and we also criticize our friends and our children, and so it goes on, this cycle continues, but then our health starts to suffer. We may get sinus infections, bladder infections. There's a lot of things, fibromyalgia, I had all of those things, and I started to grow tumors. So our mental state and state of our heart, I call it the state of the union, the heart is the state of the union, when those things are crippled and we're not feeling good and healthy, and our thoughts are constantly crippling us, they're acidic, actually creating acidity in the body. So when that happens, then our health suffers. We could get cancer. A lot of people do. So what I'm telling you today is, if you feel compelled to help someone, help yourself first. Turn that into you first, because until we love and accept ourselves completely, we're really no good to anybody else. We've got to love us first. We've got to give to ourselves first. We've got to have the tapes playing in our head that are positive, that are uplifting, rather than depleting, negative, and criticizing. So some of the things that happen with people that are criticized a lot, like I said, they feel this great void of emptiness inside. They may feel lost. They may feel that they're not enough. They're not deserving. They're not valued. They're invalidated. Even their feelings, because what often happens is when a parent is criticizing or trying to help and fix us, then, you know, we don't feel heard. And then our emotional state suffers, or their emotional state suffers. So we have to really accept ourselves, and then we're going to love and accept others as well. So what happens is what's happening inside is also happening outside. The way we feel about ourselves. Now, my mother obviously didn't feel good about herself. And that's why she was criticizing everyone else. And to this day, she's a lot better than she used to be. But it's taken a long time. She's 95 years old, you know. When are we going to get it right? And the truth of the matter is that as long as we are filled with this self-hatred and self-loathing, it's non-acceptance. We're not feeling good about ourselves. And this state of the union here needs to be loving, accepting, and joyful. And so shifting those thoughts and feelings, I'm just going to give you a couple of little tools. So just let's take a breath together. So I'm looking at, I'm trying to read your comments upside down, Debbie. Oh, to hear me. Debbie had to get on her phone to hear me. Ah, yeah. So Deb is a hypnotherapist as well in Georgia. And so she's in the same line of work as I am. So helping people with self-esteem. So, and this is a big deal because when people have low self-esteem, it's really hard to feel happy. So it took me well into my 50s before, you know, I really kicked this habit. And I'm going to share a couple of those tools. So uncross your arms and legs and sit upright. And then let's just take a deep breath together. Close your eyes. Palms up. Somebody's excited. Okay, breathe in. We're going to all breathe in together. I just feel somebody's heart fluttering like crazy. Breathe. All the way to the top. And now exhale slowly, slowly, slowly exhale. Let's do that one more time. Breathing in deeply. Expand your chest, shoulders back, chest out. All the way to the top. Hold your breath for a second. Okay, now slowly, slowly, slowly exhale. Let's do this one more time. And there's a method to my madness. Breathing in. Exhaling. So what I've discovered is that people that suffer from low self-esteem are not breathing deeply. In fact, many people will find that when I bring their attention to it, they're holding their breath almost all day long. So I suggest to counteract this, to set your alarm on your phone at the top of the hour. Every hour, have your alarm go off to remind you to breathe. And breathing is affirming life. So when we're barely breathing, we feel like we don't even deserve oxygen. We feel like we're taking up too much space. So what I am suggesting is breathe in, expand your lungs, throw your arms back, and declare to the universe, the world, to God, whoever, I deserve to be here. Let's do this together. Take a deep breath. I deserve to be here. I deserve oxygen. I affirm life. So breathing deeply is one thing that will help bring you in the present. It will help to ground you. And it will help you to feel more vital, more grounded. And if you do this often enough, and it takes 28 to 30 days to create a new habit, so we have to do this every single day, but you are going to gradually start to feel better because you're oxygenating your blood. You're affirming that you deserve to be here, and you do. And you deserve to be vitally healthy. All right, so then the second thing that I'm going to just share, and this may sound a little crazy and it may not feel comfortable at first, but this mantra, and I'm giving you a mantra in English, but mantras traditionally were in Sanskrit. This one is very simple. I love me. And when you don't love yourself, you may feel or hear the background, that little monkey mind could be saying, you don't love you. This is BS. This isn't true, but that's okay. Still say it. I love me. I am deserving. I am enough. Oh boy, did you feel that? Let's do that one more time. I love me. I am deserving. I am enough. And it doesn't hurt to put your hands on your hips and do the Wonder Woman pose. Stand like that for about a minute and a half and see how much more powerful you feel. There's a TED talk about it. It's a very powerful pose. And you don't have to be a woman to do it. You can call it the Superman pose. So, if you feel that you are trying to fix others or help others, that's a sign that your internal unconscious voice is saying things that aren't very nice about you. Because we have a tendency to want to fix people outside. We see their issues, we see their problems a lot more readily than we see our own. But we have to start with us first. Because until we are whole, feeling whole and complete as we are, feeling that love internally, the state of the union is in love with ourselves. And I'm not talking about being egocentric or narcissistic or selfish. I'm just saying, put the oxygen mask. This is a flight attendant, Jennifer, speaking here. Put the oxygen mask on you first. Take care of you first. I love me. I am deserving. I am enough. Okay, so that's it from me, Jennifer Elizabeth Masters, for tonight, but I will have something for you tomorrow. So remember, float those mantras in the background of your mind upon awakening, while you're in the shower, while you're shaving, putting on makeup, while you're driving. You can say them out loud, but you can also just float them in the background of your mind while you're doing mundane tasks like cooking dinner, driving, shaving, putting on makeup. They will access the unconscious mind much more readily at those times and right before sleep. So I'm Jennifer Elizabeth Masters. Thank you so much for watching. I do appreciate you. I love you. Thanks for watching.